Hello, I'm Roy Masters, and I'm going to be talking about a very intimate subject. You'll note an almost all-male audience, 70% at least. And the subject is, what makes women tick? Next week I'll have what makes men talk. Tick-tock.
No. The following lecture was produced by the Foundation of Human Understanding. And now let's join Roy Masters.
Hello, I'm Roy Masters, and I'm going to be talking about a very intimate subject. You'll note an almost all-male audience, 70% at least. And the subject is, what makes women tick? Next week I'll have what makes men talk. Tick-tock. No, we'll do it on men next time. But women are very peculiar creatures. And all the poets and all the know-its that thought they knew it, they've been talking about this and scratching their heads for thousands of years. And she is a very perplexing creature. And all she really needs is to be understood. And understanding, well, to find this understanding takes a great deal of selflessness. But men being the selfish animals that they are, sorry, gentlemen, but, you know, we're not any good. Least of all for women. That's an admission. Being what they are, they just sort of want something from the woman, and they get it every way they can possibly conceive of. And we're going to be talking about this, and I hope to have enough material and interest to carry this program throughout the whole week. But before I take my first question, I hope that you do have a question. You must have some kind of puzzlement concerning women. What makes them do this, and what makes them do that, and why this and why that? Gentlemen, you do, don't you? Otherwise, what did you come here for? You're right. So before I take that first question, we have a first question? Okay, one. Second question? Ooh, two. All right, we've got two. Maybe we'll go from there. I must say this, I'm giving a month's notice to the station because we can't make it. The support for this program has nosedived to practically zero. I think the holidays had something to do with it. People all sort of spread out in their giving. They're not really giving. They're under a compulsion to be taken. But they think of it as giving. So whatever the reason is, I can't afford to finance it anymore. You know, we lost $100,000, so it's not coming back. And I'm sorry to say that you people have lost a great opportunity, I think, to, you know, to be enlightened, at least on radio, on TV. But you can listen to me on radio on in Los Angeles at 8:40, 8:70 on the dial, 9 o'clock in the morning, KIEV. I would have liked to have kept the program going, but I got no feedback, very little money. Oh, I'm not a pressure person, I'm not a used car salesman, TV evangelist. You either see the value of it and cough up, otherwise to hell with you, okay? Pardon the expression. If you haven't got the sense to see the value of this to you and your family, if you haven't got that sense and you'd rather watch, you know, My Three Sons or whatever it is, reruns, whatever it is, if you haven't got the sense, if that's what you'd rather have, then that's the way the cookie crumbles. Now, who has the first question? Yes, sir.
I wanted to find out, how do you get someone out of their emotional moment, shall we say, when they're into their emotional ties?
You're talking about women?
Specifically my wife.
Is this your wife?
No, right here, yes.
Is that your wife here? Yeah. Well, you just have to understand women are peculiar creatures. Men are also peculiar in their fallen state, but we're now talking about the peculiarity of women. And there's not one of them that's any different. It may be Margaret Thatcher and her ilk. I mean, these ladies are beautiful ladies. But of course, you couldn't think of having sex with Margaret Thatcher. You see? But, you know, because it would be She's too innocent, too dignified. See, a dignified lady is a turnoff to a man. He has to find a woman that will offer herself, degrade herself, or he has to find some woman, even a child, that he can degrade and tear her spirit up, destroy her innocence, to get at something, the nucleus of her soul, something that's deep down in there, draw out, siphon out, something to support his pride. His pride, his animalistic pride, can ravage itself on. Ladies, the ladies that are here, do you understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I'm coming to your question in just a little while, because women, in their fallen state, they live in a state of denial like man. As a matter of fact, women help man. Women is a helpmate in this respect, that she helps. She's programmed by man's need, man's ravaging, man's pressures, his urgency to survive as an ego. She's pressured and conforms to supplying this need to help a man deny that he is not a man. There is no such thing as a man. It's only men that think they're men. They're apes. See, woman made a monkey out of man, and men need, those monkey men need women to help them to think that the monkey is a man. Follow? And that's the way it's ever been since a long time. But women live in a state of denial. And if you'd had, forgive me for going, I have to go this way to answer your question. If a man lived on a desert island, the fallen man, the earthy man, and the woman lived on another desert island, and they never saw each other, there probably wouldn't be much mischief. He might find himself, and she might find herself. And if they ever came together, they probably wouldn't need each other and ravage each other that way, because they would have found what would completed them without one another. Okay? I'm leading up to a very important point. The trouble is, we don't have such a situation. And men do not live on islands, and women don't live on islands. But we bring these men and women together in their fallen state, and some strange things begin to happen. Some very strange psychological things begin to occur. It's almost like when the sperm and the ova come together, there's a new creation. I mean, you keep them apart and there's no magic. But when you bring them together, there's also some things begin to happen. Some psychic forces begin to work, and it draws the elements together, and it forms a new creature. Well, we have this sort of thing going on between man and woman, because man, there is an inner man. See, and then there's an inner woman. Your outsides are just shells, but you have an inside self as well as an outside self. You know that. When you do wrong, this inside self is in conflict with an even deeper inside self. There's even like layers, there's levels. So this inside self This inside self is formed through the cohabitation with the woman's inside self. And the inside self of a woman is on a very deep and dark level. Now, women live, look, I must tell you, as a professional hypnotist, I used to be, there's very little I don't know. I know more than the average bear, the average psychiatrist. I know them more than all of them put together. I mean, I have spent my whole life at it, so I don't say I know everything, but I know as much as there is known, at least, altogether. And I know that women, like hypnotized people, psychotic people, live somewhere below their ears. Now, psychotic people or hypnotized people do not know that they are hypnotized. The cultural man, generally speaking, the masses, live on a very low level of knowing. They do not know that they do not know. I know I don't know. I'm a much higher level. are much smarter. See, Socrates thought himself to be smart because he asked all the artisans, and they didn't know that they didn't know. But he knew he didn't know, therefore he counted himself as the wisest. See, and on this level, but women live on a lower level than men. And there's something in a woman that's always drawing men down to that level. And they live in a world of fantasy, romance. The feminine side of a woman, men have a need, a hunger, to buy into that world, because by buying into that world, by meshing his consciousness with her consciousness, they experience the forbidden delights of pride and glory. You know, you ladies know how men want you to put them on a pedestal, and you feel that that's your duty is fulfilled when you have your Prince Charming, and he may not be a Prince Charming, he's probably a frog. But you take this frog and you imagine he's a Prince Charming, and he loves it. You know, there's a couple of ladies laughing in here. It's not so funny, but most men are frogs. They think they're Prince Charming, and their whole life is wrapped around some female form. Good Lord!
Excuse me.
It's okay. Hell's calling. Doesn't want you to hear this. But you probably said to hell, call me if it gets hot. Okay. Now, I don't mean to offend ladies. I really don't, because I have a daughter of my own and she loves me. But she doesn't have the mind of a woman. I brought her up with the mind of a man. I've saved her from her own mind. I've saved her from her dark side, which is the guileful side, the part that where a woman usually lives and operates from, and pulls men into for a power trip. Because if they can't get love and correction from this state, they substitute that for the worshipfulness of the beast. She's the beauty, you know, and she's worshipped by the beast, and then she feels like she is the queen or the king of the castle, the origin of this fantasy or this creation. And creating man in her own image, creating this prince out of a frog. Because in reality, he's becoming more of a frog. He becomes a toad, and then, I don't know, toadstool. Then just plain stool. Excuse me. Can't resist that. Now she gets it. But the point is, there's a funny side, but I'm looking at it from, does anybody disagree with me so far? I mean, I know there are certain segments of society, certain people who never understand what I just said. There will be no way that they can access this information. They can't even identify it in the intellectual form as I presented it, let alone see into it and go beyond it. So what I've said to them is absolute nonsense. Women are equal to men. They're not. Woman in her fallen state. Now remember how I said this. If you're just a rising animal, then there would be no sin. There wouldn't be no problems. We'd just be getting better and better as a human race. But if you look around, we're not rising animals, because we carry a guilt behind us, and we have tragedies before us. And our lives don't get better; they get worse. So animals, those lives don't get better. They get worse. They get better because they are, in a sense, evolving. They're improving. The way they are, and the way they are set in the world, it can only improve. They don't mutate. We are mutating, and the mutation is because of a fall, and because of there's something lurking in the female. The old snake in the grass, if you call it what you like, but the scripture calls it serpent, the wisest and the shrewdest. It operates in woman's consciousness. See, and from there it can offer delusions and illusions and all kinds of delights that are forbidden. The men dip into that. He comes across into her space. And then she's got him. This is the trouble. Yes, I'll come back to your question. Don't let me forget it. Because we're working toward it, because it's an ultimate question.
You had said that you brought your daughter up with the mind of a man. Could you explain that? Because
I saved her from her mother. I saved myself from my mother. I saved myself from my wife. I didn't really save myself, but God saved me. You understand what I mean? I found the truth that set me free from the beguilement of the female. Now, my wife still is beguiled, but she's got no power. Absolutely no power. She cannot hurt me. She cannot manipulate me. She has no power with sex. I don't buy her being nice to me. I don't get upset when she's cruel to me. I stay in my space. I will not come across to her space. She's all alone in her own space. Now, there come a time where she can come across to my space. But unless I'm in my space, she can't come across to it. If I'm in her space, then how can we come across to any other space? We're already in the wrong space, aren't we, when we're in her space? You understand that women do not understand their own madness. They're not aware that they're not aware. They're not aware of their powers. They have a body, and all they have to do is wiggle it. Can you imagine, sir, having a body that all you had to do is wiggle, and everything would, you know, all the nails would fly out of the ceiling, and everything would attract itself to you, like you're the king of the universe. You don't have to be too smart, do you? So then you trade on that, and you begin to learn to cultivate the sensitivity to that, so it's like a bully. You don't really have any power, but when your strength is the power, in order to be more strong, you must be more of a bully. So you have to become more ruthless. So it is with a woman. She has to become more, she must become more beautiful and more manipulative. And she must cultivate the weakness, exploit the weakness. And when she gets old and ugly, well, then you see the dark side, and the beautiful witch becomes the ugly witch. Because then you can do the same thing with ugliness. And ugliness is what you faced when you on your mother's breast. Ugliness is what your father brought out. He didn't know he was dealing with it. He was cultivating it for his own ego pleasure taking, don't you see? That's why all marriages fail. They all fail. And if they succeed, you only live in quiet desperation. That's all there is to it. You stay together because of finances or the children. They all fail. I have never seen a happy marriage. Now I've got kids who are going to be happy because I've brought up men. And they are attracted to ladies who want to be saved from their space. But if they haven't got a man who is in the space they want to come to, how can they come to it? There is no hope. The man is always flying into her space and then taking refuge in it from the conscience that he's left behind. Boy, I didn't know I was going to do so good this evening. Yes.
Yesterday was my first day of enlightenment.
It was.
I called you and I told you that I hated all men except for you, and I particularly hated homosexuals. I have a homosexual son. And when I called you, I was so nervous and so scared, and something didn't want me to call you.
Yes, that's the dark side of you.
Yes. Today, I'm in such a complete different space of enlightenment. I want the correction, and you're the only person I know that gives that correction, and I love that correction.
And you love what's in me.
Yes.
But you don't. But you respect me, but you love what is in me. See, I can,
yes.
I can live with that.
Mm-hmm.
I can live with the respect because it is proper that you respect me. But I could not live that you love me, because you must love what's in me, because you're in the same space as me and you have the mind of a man. You start to think like a man. You start to be reasonable like a man. Women in their fallen condition are not reasonable creatures.
And I can attest to
that. Gentlemen, are they? You become subject to their unreasonableness. Pardon?
They don't have understanding in their fallen condition, I don't believe.
No, but they don't want you. See, once Once you start to fall, they taste your blood. Once you start, they're like a tiger, an old tiger. Once it starts to taste human blood, you see, it gets lazy and thirsty for it. And other game is not, no longer, natural game is not interesting. They want to consolidate their power. Now, there is an unreasonable force, and that's what women are, totally unreasonable. They may not seem to be in the beginning, they are so supportive, but we'll come to that in a minute. They're unreasonable, and of course it's unreasonable for man to look for love, because there's an unreasonable part looking for the unreasonable, that which created him. See what I mean? And he thinks that's love. And then he finds himself subject to an unreasonable being, and it's a reverse state. Whereas a man in his reason is absolutely stubborn. Roy Masters is as stubborn as hell, but it's heaven. You know what I mean? And so when I know I'm right, you can't move me off of it. And a whole hell can come against me, and it's not going to work. And so that everybody, when my kids right away, when they see the beautiful part of it, when they see that I'm right, there's such a strength in it. No anger. I'm not going to frighten them off. It almost, they can see ahead of time, they can feel the aura of it, and it discourages them from arguing with me. But if they do, it makes them guilty. I mean, I don't make them guilty, but the fact that I glow brighter and makes them see how wrong they are is their salvation. They'll say, sorry, Dad. And then they are on, there's no losers. And if I win, they win. You understand that? So therefore, if I'm as right as a man, if I win, my wife wins. But a woman is the reverse of that. When she wins, you both lose. You understand? Because in her unreasonableness, have you ever tried to reason with an unreasonable woman? The more right you are, the more crazy she thinks you are. That's the liberal mind. The liberal mind is feminine. The men who have bought into, who are being feminized, who have lost their male identity and have taken on some semblance of homosexuality. They're not homosexuals yet, they're the woman's man. They don't have a man's mind anymore, therefore they have the compassion and the clever, unreasonable reasoning of a woman. They make great lawyers for the working for the civil rights, whatever the groups or whatever the Civil Liberties Union, or whatever they are, the ACLU, they got all those people working for them, liberals and feminine minds. I mean, they could twist anything around and make sanity seem like insanity. You see? Well, we went through a half an hour, didn't we, pretty fast. Didn't know a half an hour went by. If this was Dynasty, it would have got a lot slower. Now, you can see why this program isn't supported that well. Because people don't want to hear this. It's painful to see that we are fallen beings. We'd much rather think that we're risen beasts. No sin, no guilt. And we keep buying into those ideas, and so the dark side of us wants us to believe that. But it's the downfall of the United States. You see that with this idea is prevalent in our society. No sin. In a free state of rising being. It's not true. It's a lie. And this is the chaos. It's spreading from a female source. Now, I'm not saying that I'm not against women, I understand, because I think women are almost relieved to hear a man understand them. I'm not criticizing the woman. What I'm saying is I see the woman needs to be saved from herself. A woman cries to be saved from herself. She cries, she's a prisoner of that self. How does she long for a man not to fall? To be noble, for a man she can't manipulate, for a man that won't fall. Where are you, swines? Right? You're all pigging out in every woman you can. And women are, there's so many whores and so many beasts with whores that, you know, that the consciousness of man is lower than a worm's belly. See? There's very few that can understand. So how are you going to keep the program on the air when you have a few seeking souls? There's always been a small number. So maybe you few seeking souls can support the program, because this is the first week of my notice to the station, and I'm going off the air. and it will and never come back again because it's cost too much to get it going. I just lost $100,000 because you didn't respond. You sat on your thumbs, and you did some of it. Well, thank you for those of you who did. You know, I appreciate it, but what about those of you who didn't? This program costs money to keep on the air. And where will you find? Where will you find anything like this? Anywhere. Public television run by liberals. You don't expect to find enlightenment. You find the artsy, schmartsy stuff over there. You know, the pansy stuff. You know, the meaningless things made meaningful. Is that right or not? So, pardon?
Like Nova or something like that? I think that's
well, right. Yeah, so you'll find some good stuff, but for the most part, you're not going to find anything like this, because Nova would be more intellectual and it's really not threatening to the ego.
Right.
See? So we've got, what we have is the threatening factor, the ego-threatening factor, which we must experience. Our egos must be threatened in order that we must face ourselves. We must be brought face to face with the information that we're afraid to look at. That men are nothing. You know, there's a sign over an old mining town in the old days. I think I can remember the sign that says, men are fools and women are devils in disguise. You see, there's a lot of truth to that. Now, it's not a condemnation of women. We have to understand the condition of man and woman. So each knows what they must do in order to rise. You don't need a man to be saved. But anyway, we are going off the air at the end of the month. So, please ask for the cassettes and the book, 3 cassettes and a book, to teach you how to learn to deal with your own self, to come back into the space you belong in, and take charge of your life, and it will teach you how to do it. It's a meditation exercise. It will be a charge of life itself. Please listen to me on radio in Los Angeles if you happen to be here. I'm all over the country, so wherever you happen to be, we'll give you our magazine, and you can look us up and find us on a dial somewhere. 870 on the dial, 9 a.m. in the morning. Thanks for listening, and join us again. Hello, I'm Roy Masters, and we're talking about what makes a woman tick, and if you've missed the first segment, you really should get a copy of the program because it's hot stuff. But what I was saying roughly, that women have their own space, and it's somewhere below their ears. Oh, I'm going to have everybody up, all the women lip movements up in arms. Unfair to women or something or other. But it's true. Women are not the same as men, psychologically, emotionally. They're very emotional, irrational creatures. And they're governed by forces they don't see. And they're unconsciously luring men into their space. And they usually succeed. And when men do fall into that space, they are subject to the spirit of that space. They lose their manhood, they lose control. They struggle to get it back with violence and rage sometimes. Or they acquiesce and give in. Once a man has fallen into that space, mind becomes remolded from without. The scripture teaches us our mind should be remolded from within. But his mind becomes revolted. See, her mind is molded from within, or molded, as in mold. See, and his mind is the extension of her mind. And that's what's wrong with society. The man becomes a slave. He loses his masculinity. He cannot understand how this comes about. And as I said in my earlier program, it's because he comes into that space to get away from the truth, to rebel against truth. He seeks his helpmate in his rebellion. He comes into that space. He joins forces with what's in a woman, and it gets into him. And it changes him, and it alters his thinking. He either conforms, and my producer will hate when I say this, and becomes a liberal, a feminine thinking man. That's what they are, I'm sorry. And this is not political, it's just, you'll notice that feminine thinking men are quick to surrender to adversary. See, you see how they give in to the strongest pressures, the most seductive pressures. They buy Gorbachev. They buy the seductive pressures. They give in to that because they are made of that. And they love that because they are made of it, and they are loved by that, encouraged to be that way, not to think there's anything wrong with that. See, it's a love force. The femininity represents love. Not true love. If you've noticed in the media lately, we call it the reason why Mr. Bork was not nominated, because he didn't have compassion. I'm just using that as an example. It's because of no compassion. Now, the people of the feminine thinking man, the feminine thinking woman, is, remember, woman is a creature of love. Love or compassion for the ego of a man. The ego of a man comes down to accept that compassion because it's supportive for his ego. But when he does, he becomes a slave of it, and he becomes shaped by it, and he conforms to it. His whole existence is from it. And then he begins to have the same kind of compassion. He thinks like a woman, but it's a man. And he seduces like a woman. He loves like a woman. He doesn't deal with men like men deal with men. He deals with men like you could become a homosexual. Follow that? You do, don't you? And that explains it. See, in other words, that eventually the what we call liberalism is prelude, is a feminine thinking person giving in to the tyrant. Tyrants are always feminine. Hitler was not masculine. He hated his father. He bought into his mother. He was part man, part woman, part devil. He was a tyrant. When men eventually have the mind of a woman, they become a tyrant, whether it's communist, socialist, or conservative, fascist. See, the men tend to be, and the reason is that you'll see why that conservatives tend to be, although not right, more moralistic and more right-thinking, but dictatorial with right-thinking. They, you know, like Baptists, they got right-thinking, but they run it down your throat. Got it? The Catholic Church, right-thinking in a sense, well, I mean, it's more feminine, but most churches are dictatorial, you see. They ram it down your throat, but the left tends to be compassionate, doesn't deal with terms of law and honor and justice. It deals with, well, let's put it this way. If a poor man is in court, the liberal thinking person, the feminine thinking person, you must understand that, will say, well, the rich man can afford better than a poor man, why not give justice to the poor man? But that's not justice. Justice should be for the poor man and for the rich man. If the fine is $1,000, it should be a fine of $1,000 for both of them. Never mind rich man or poor man. That's the law. Compassion would destroy the law. And we think that was love. Passion. So men tend to be reasonable, but the way women overcome the reason of men is with love. Their love, the feminist or feminine thinking men think that love is greater than truth. You see? It becomes truth, don't you see? And then, when in a man in his rebellious state, he has the semblance of knowledge of right. Men tend to be halfway thinking, reasonable creatures to begin with. But that truth and justice is destroyed and overcome by woman's support for his ego. Until his need for the woman is greater than his sense of moral duty after a while. You see how I say that? That's the reason why you could become an animal. And so therefore, that there are forces in this world, the feminine thinking man and the feminist or the feminist thinking woman, who wants control, does not want a man to be prevail with reason. What they do, they try his life. They try his soul. They make it very difficult for him to bring up his family. In other words, the man will leave in the morning and leave some instructions. Honey, I want you to do this. While he's gone, she'll say, Dad won't find out, to the kids. She'll sabotage his orders. When he comes home, he finds things have gone wrong, that the kids have disobeyed. He starts to get upset. He has to use more force. In his anger, he feels betrayed. use more force than is necessary with his truth. Then he begins to see, the children see truth in a bad light. And they opt for compassion. They look for the mother's love, who spoils them. Ladies, are you guilty of this? How many ladies are guilty of this? Good, I'm glad to see. You see, now you see the forces. What I'm looking at the world now, what we need to do is not only look at the man-woman relationship, but see how the whole world is dominated by this. That men tend in their rebellion to go to the right, but they become, well, the Ku Klux Klan is Christian and God and country, and they got a few good principles, but they've gone too far. Follow that? They just, I know this, and again, I'm not trying to be political, it's just weaving in, what you see is sexual politics. You see sex in extreme right and extreme left. And that the devil, the head of the extreme left and right is the devil. They both have the same God, because they evolved madness between them until there's nothing left in the center. The children get destroyed between the war between the left and the right until there is no more right. There's only dictatorship, either fascist man, communist woman. See, I'm just using that label to make a point. Now, if we had at the highest levels of government understand this, if we were an enlightened nation, which we're not, we would not be subject to the seductions that you find in our society. And thank God there's enough of us who don't know why we know, but we know that something wrong with that, you know, what's going on. We know there's something wrong with the left and the right, but we don't know why we know, but we hold our ground, and we're able to, those of us who are able to hold our ground, we're able to flower from that ground. That's what I'm trying to teach you to do. Now, you had some more thoughts on,
Yes, I did have thoughts on that, Roy, because I know that I am guilty from what you're talking from. From one side to the other, now I can speak. I had that kind of a mind that I needed the control. I wanted that control. I was very seductive. With my children, I might add. Yes, very much so. It came through the children. They were my vehicle that I used.
Against your husband?
Against my husband.
Women nearly always do that to their husband. And it's a horrible thing because the man has some duty. He brings some kids in the world and he's got some kind of obligations. And, you know, he's got some attachments to those children and there's duties to discharge. And you start messing with them and you create rage.
And I did. See? And my rage was centered in religion as well. I was going to make them behave and be good. And I forced everything on them in religion.
Well, first of all, you made them bad.
Yes.
Then you make them. This is a typical female thing. You create the problem and you solve it.
Solve it.
See, that's government. You create the problem and you solve it.
I see this today very clearly because I'm over.
Because you don't solve it, by the way.
No.
You make
no.
a bigger problem by trying to solve it.
Exactly.
And then you solve that. Then you have a full-time job in your universe. Your universe will always need you because it's full of problems calling to you.
But I see my need for the correction.
You do?
I do see that. And because I'm looking at it now, and I can see it, now I can see what I did do, that I didn't have the understanding of why I was doing it.
Yes, but you see, because you, what is understanding but the mind of a man? The mind of a man is really the mind of God, man's soul sharing the space of God. Mm-hmm. Isn't that right? What I'm saying, whatever that means, man is no longer an animal and prideful animal, but he's able then to lead the woman out of her animal state. Otherwise, he wants her to be an animal to serve his animal state. Don't you see? Mm-hmm. Even if they technically wanted a woman to be better, even if they knew how to do it, they wouldn't do it because the ego can't stand alone without the support of a wrong woman. A woman must be made wrong by a man's relationship. A man cannot have a right relationship with a woman because the act of being right with her would correct her. Therefore, he cannot get support from a market. He cannot get support for his for his ego from a Margaret Thatcher. Margaret Thatcher will always make him look like the ass that he is. See? What he wants is a woman that's vulnerable. He wants a woman that's slimy. He wants to have a woman that is not conflicted. She has no shame. So therefore he loses his guilt and her shamelessness. It's like salvation because you have no shame. See? For the fallen state. See? They use that word in psychology, unconflicted beings. And they find this whole nation. Why do you think we worship the scumbags on the stage? You know, screen and radio. The lowest types are held up because we, in our guilt, we have to find something ever lower to emotionally involve ourselves with. We must find an unconflict, shameless, more and more shameless being. As we become more guilty, they have to be lower, ever lower, so that the adventure of escaping is possible to a lower dimensions. That's why men degrade women. That's why we call it tricks. They have to learn new tricks. They have to degrade themselves for man's to enter into. In other words, she keeps retiring behind these veils, the seven veils, whatever you want to call them. She has to keep coming more and more mysterious, more alluring, more tempting, more exciting. The closer she gets to hell, the more exciting she is. The more it becomes a new adventure for man to a new. She steps back, and there's another border, and then men cross that border, and she steps back, and there's another border. But men will take innocent children. Men, when they find themselves involved with women and controlled by mature women who are smart, they take an innocent child and take pleasure in tearing the innocence open to pull out that hell to serve them. You see that? And that's called sexual molestation. Who understands me? This is what we're not looking at our society. All our stupid experts, and they're all stupid. They're stupid if they don't understand this. Okay, there was a gentleman over here, and then we got to a lady over there. Was it you?
Back to.
Did you have the question, or you want me to go to somebody else?
No, that's okay. Back to the question I had earlier, I think I have some understanding now that basically when someone is in their emotional track, there's no point in really trying to get them out of it. Just by being strong, coming from the light, and not buying into them, they have to get out of it.
Your original question was, how do you deal with an emotional woman?
Right.
But don't you see, your state of being lost in her space requires the emotional gravity. It's an emotional thing, see. It's the emotional energy that ties you and anesthetizes your brain against the conscience and provides you with the input of illusion. Your emotional involvement with her and hers with you provides you with the lies. It energizes the lies that's coming from her space, that fantasy, that illusion that you're something, and at the same time it neatly anesthetizes your conscience so that you feel like you're in heaven when you really are in hell. The moment that you feel like you're in heaven is the same moment as hell. And then when the feeling of the moment settles, you're looking at skull and crossbones. Is that right?
Yes, I see that. Thank you.
It's the same with any emotional involvement. What you must learn to be is, in other words, you have to be unemotionally involved with a woman. And if you are unemotionally involved, it means something to a woman. It means that you are involved already. You already have your completeness. It doesn't depend upon emotionally involving yourself to flow into her, so that she can flow into you. She gives you the light, you give her your energy, and she gives you back illusion. You have this emotional connection. So therefore, a woman knows that. And the moment you start puffing and panting, you know how you are. Oh, darling, I love you. It goes on for hours, you know. You see, it's a state of being a. it's a state of being emotionally drained and emotionally reinforced, and of course it gives a tremendous power to a woman. It's a tremendous power. That's how you give the power. You're giving her energy. As you fall to come into a space, you decay. You effervesce. A woman feels what a man feels. So if she can make him feel, she feels what he feels, and that feeling is her life and her power. But if a man doesn't fall, he can have sex with his wife without too much emotional, getting anything ego out of it, without fantasy, then not much harm is done. He also won't become addicted. It's just like going to the toilet. You know, you don't get addicted to that. It's just something natural. You know what I mean? It doesn't become more and more. There's not a need for it to be more and more and more and more when you're using something to grow from, to escape into. Yes.
When a woman eventually acquires the mind of a man, does she then become equal, per se, to a risen man?
Yes. The ultimate state that not many people know about would be like that. She wouldn't be his equal. But she would want to be. She would be equal in this sense, that she'd know her place. That the only problem with equality comes in with ego. When you have ego, you are concerned with who is above and who is below. But with love, when you both find out who you are, both in your center, both with the light of the Creator in you, her willing to do his will as a helpmate to the man, she will be in agreement with him. And I got it now? In other words, she is not less than the man, because she's not subject to the man, only to the degree physically. She sees that the man is right. She loves the man for being right. But there's the love of right in her that is able to detect the man's right and go along with it. But the man's right is her own right. It's her own good as well as his good.
You see, natural order.
There's a natural order thing. There's no ego. Yeah. A woman would be happy to. After all, man should be happy to love God. A woman should be happy to love the man that loves God. And the children will be happy to love them both. Which means to obey them. There's no humility in obeying somebody you love, seeking to please them. But the trouble is we seek the opposite. We end up pleasing the people we hate. See? The people who eventually give us lies and emotions instead of love. You follow that? Young man, you're stirring. Did you have a question?
Yes, I did. Okay, so in order to find a woman that is like this, you have to become right with yourself then, right?
First.
Right.
In other words, you have to hold out. You can't go screwing around with every woman. You've got to be different from all the other men, otherwise you won't shine. I mean, you just get lost in the shuffle, you get lost in the pack. What difference are you? You're just as lowly and scummy and as nothing as the rest of them. You know, all those people now turning the dial, they're going to be very disturbed the way I say, because they don't like to see themselves described that way.
That's the truth.
Is that right? So you have to stand out, and the woman has to hold out, not put out. See? She has to do that, and otherwise she identifies herself with this. It's a low life.
How do you overcome this? By meditation?
Yeah, the meditation will bring you to that space. And when you're in that space, even though you have urges and compulsions like everybody else, you don't follow them. You don't repress them. You're not busy creating them. See, most men, they like the feelings. They're looking for those connections. They're looking for opportunities to be aroused and to feel and to lose themselves into that space. On a deeper levels of animal and brutishness or animalisticness. I couldn't find the right word. Follow that? So they're always arousing themselves. If they don't have a woman to arouse them, they'll think of a woman and arouse themselves and lose themselves in that space. It's called fantasy. Now you see, you've never known of any other world except that world of fantasy and that's centered in a woman. And women have never known anything else but that world which is centered on herself. But I'm afraid, ladies and gentlemen, unless we are willing to look, you know, switch dials, switch stations, and leave that world behind, be willing to leave it behind and go on to better things. Okay, you've got to be married. You need a woman. You need a woman. A man needs a woman. A woman needs a man to work their problems through. Otherwise, if men and women come together unenlightened, they simply renew the ancient contract of what I call original sin. Women support the ego. Men degrade the women for that ego support, having no tolerance for anything good because they're no damn good themselves. They don't want to be faced with a good woman. They want a woman that makes them feel good. They don't want a woman. That's a good woman to them, the one that makes them. That's the biggest whore on the block. Is that right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, you know it too, don't you?
This concludes CD 1. For more information, please write to Post Office Box 1000. Grants Pass, Oregon, 97528. Or call us toll-free at 1-800-877-3227. You may also visit us on the World Wide Web at www.fhu.com.